Hey guys, how are you doing? How are you doing? How are you doing? We are doing very much better this week. I just wanted to say, hey, film a podcast, just update you on life stuff, update you on yarn stuff. So welcome, welcome, welcome. This is the Littlebean and Me podcast channel. I'd like to welcome you if you're brand new, if you happened upon this podcast. This is a podcast about crocheting and mostly yarn dyeing, knitting, spinning, just pretty much all the crafty things that I do. And if you're a returning subscriber, thank you so very much for coming back. I super appreciate it. As you may recall from last week, I was very sick. We were all very sick, still just recovering so slowly this winter. I feel like it's been one cold after the next, after the next, after the next. So I'm happy to be feeling better. Both my kids are pretty much feeling better. My husband is almost better. So we are on an upswing, which is great, which means I get more things done and I'm in a better mood. And so hopefully the podcast is a little bit more enjoyable than last week. My voice last week, I watched back the podcast and I start off kind of normal, and then as it goes on my voice gets more hoarse and more quiet because I can't speak up. Anyway, welcome, welcome, welcome. I hope that you guys enjoy. If you'd like to be subscribed, you can always hit the subscribe button on YouTube right below the video, and there's also a little bell notification, so if you want to be notified of when I upload a new video, it'll automatically send you a push notification. You don't have to subscribe. If you want to subscribe, great. And if you don't, that's great too. It's free. It's what you want it to be. So, it's still winter. And Mother Nature has confirmed that for us, that over this past weekend, we had some crazy snowstorms, probably around a foot of accumulation here. Last night we had some more snow. It is, I want to say, 3 inches of really heavy wet snow. It makes it look very pretty outside, but not necessarily the nicest to shovel or remove or off of your car, or when it slides off the roof of your car onto your windshield while you're driving. That's not very fun either. So yeah, it's still winter time here. Still cranking along. Hopefully we start changing weather when appropriate, but soon, hopefully sooner than later. I don't really care for the winter. Sorry, it's so pretty, but I really, just with the two little kids, just, ooh, I'm all set with that. So, there are some things I want to talk about today. So, I'm going to talk about, I have one finished object and one work in progress that's almost finished. If you follow me on Instagram, you've probably already seen these, both of these things. As you know, last week I put the coastline shawl in timeout because I'm very frustrated with my needle choice and the way that it's knitting up and the size of it and just everything about it is making me not want to knit on it. So I've put it away. I've reclaimed my foot cutout from behind the couch finally. So, and this is a sectional. I know you can't see it, but it's like this L shape over on the side of the frame. You can't see, but it takes a lot to move it. So I had to have some help moving it. Got my foot cut out, so now I can continue working on my gradient socks, which I'll probably end up doing more over this weekend. But anyway, so I have two things to share with you on that front. I also have some dye work to share with you, and I don't have any specific dye topics to talk about today. I didn't solicit for questions today, and I do have some shop update information pertaining to last week's update and what is still in the shop and what will be coming to the shop in the next couple of weeks. So if you're interested in all of that, just stay where you are. And if you're not, then I'll see you later. just kidding. excuse me, sorry. So let's just start off with a finished object. So the finished object I have is a sock. It is my first official finished, but not finished sock off of my circular sock machine. If you've been around for a few episodes here, I purchased a circular sock machine. It's an Erlbacher Speedster. I have a 60 stitch cylinder and a 72 stitch cylinder along with a couple of rivers, and I was able to knit up a sock, I want to say 3 days ago during nap time, and I wanted to share it with you today. So the yarn that it's knit up in is my own hand-dyed yarn. and it's knit up in the Mooney colorway, which looks like this. It is, this is on the sparkle sock base, which is what I use to knit up my socks. So you see there's blues, sandy browns, and greens. So this was inspired by RJ Lupin. His nickname is Mooney because he is a werewolf. He has sandy brown hair, he has green eyes, and he's a werewolf, so I did some dark blue for the midnight sky. So that is Mooney, and that's what I stitched my sock with. Let's put this back on. Okie dokie. So then here's the cake. So this is what it looks like caked up. It's just very sparkly. I'm not sure how well the sparkles are coming across on camera right now, but it's quite sparkly and it cakes up very beautifully. You can see the little flecks of green in there. There we go, that's a pretty good shot. So you can see the little flecks of greens, browns, blues, so it comes up a bit speckled. If you follow me on Instagram or Facebook, you've seen the sock already, but this is the finished sock. I don't have a sock blocker, so it's looking all flared at the top and kind of wonky at the bottom. So I want to talk to you a little bit about this process and how this went. So I wanted to do a couple of things with this. One, I wanted to finish an actual sock using my ribber and kind of get used to the machine more, as using it for making socks, and most specifically socks that I can use to display specific colorways, because looking at a colorway in a skein and seeing how it knits up are two very different things. So if you look at how this is in the skein, you might be like, oh, it looks kind of splotchy or weird, but if it gets re-skeined or balled up, it looks different. So this is what it would look like balled up, and then this is what it looks like knit up. So this is the Mooney colorway. This is a 60 stitch sock. I did it toe up on the machine. I didn't hang my toe this time, I just did a basic toe that I would Kitchener stitch later. So the seam for the Kitchener, you can see it's really messed up, but I'll get into that, is on the bottom of the foot. And then it's a short row heel on the machine, so it's very similar to like a German short row heel or a Fishlet's Kiss heel, where you're you know, working back and forth across the rows. And then just plain stockinette I did plain stockinette for about an inch and a half above the heel, which I wish I had kept the tension the same as the heel, but I'll get into that also. And then I did a 1x1 rib for about 60 rows, and I bound off on the machine. So I used waste yarn to remove the sock from the machine, and then I was using the latch tool to bind off the stitches, but I found it to be easier just to use my normal crochet hook. So I used a very small crochet hook to finish the bind off edge. So you can see it's very stretchy. That's plenty large enough for me to get my foot in. When it's not on your leg or on a sock blocker, you can see there's a flare out here, which I'm still learning the machine. So I wanted to just, you know, get it bound off in a finished sock. So this is in itself finished. Things that I like about it and things that I don't. Sorry about if you hear ambient baby noises, but as always, Tucker is trying to put himself down to sleep, which may or may not be successful. Okay, so one regret I had was my waste yarn color. So when you are knitting on a sock machine, or any knitting machine for that matter, if you're making something that needs to have a finished edge, often you'll cast onto the machine using waste yarn that's a very different color than the yarn that you are going to be knitting with. And that makes for a couple of things. One, you can start off, so I started off on the toe doing short rows for the toe, and then I could continue with the foot of the sock and then later on stitch it together. So it allows you to do things like that. And it allows you to have a cleaner edge. So I was able to take this off the machine and then make a nice clean edge around. Even though it's like very flared, it's very even and clean. The waste yarn that I used was not as different as I thought it was going to look when it was knit up. And I've used this waste yarn before So like I have an extra, I have a skein of Slytherin Common Room that I had used for a sample, and I had extra yarn. It's just a single 100% merino, and I thought it was going to be different enough to this for me to use it because this has so many lighter tones in it, but it wasn't different enough. I need to get like electric yellow cotton thread or something that where it's completely different. So what happened was when I went later to Kitchener stitch this seam, you can see some places it looks okay, but then you'll see here, I'll put my hand in it so you can see it maybe a little bit better. So you can see right here, there are holes in the sock and the seam inside is not very pretty. So I'll show you their ends. So you can see it's not finished, but it's a finished piece. I can put this on my foot and it's not gonna fall apart. So here's the inner Kitchener. So what happens is you bind off, and then I turned my sock inside out because it's easier to Kitchener stitch that way. And I Kitchenered from this side to this side, thinking I was Kitchenering into the first row / last row of each side. So just like when you're grafting a toe together, you have it on the needles and you're like doing the knit on, purl off, knit off, purl on, something like that for the Kitchener. So you're doing a similar thing where you have the waste yarn. And if I can make some footage here, I will put extra footage in so you can see what I'm talking about more clearly. But here's the edge that is attached to waste yarn. And if you turn your sock inside out, you go in with the new, out with the old. So you're literally just making a knit stitch around, and it's very easy to visualize. But the problem I had was because my waste yarn was not different enough, I wasn't in the stitch that I thought I was in for some of these stitches. So when I pulled the waste yarn off, I ended up with holes and drop stitches that I had to just repair so that I could just have a finished sock. I'm like, I just want this to be done. It was easier on the cuff because it's only one edge that you're finishing. You're not sewing the edges together. So once I had, there are some drop stitches that I had to knit up manually with a crochet hook, but it wasn't difficult. It was less difficult to do the cuff finishing than it was the toe finishing. And even though I found when I talked a couple weeks ago about hanging my toe on the machine, where you knit the toe and then you take the edge that you would normally be Kitchenering and you place it back on the needles. Although that was difficult, I feel like I probably would have liked the outcome a lot better. It would have been cleaner. It wouldn't have been perfect, but it would have been cleaner. It would have been a wearable sock. Not that I'm using this to wear, but anyway. So then the heel went just fine. I didn't have any stitches dropped on the heel. The decreases and increases on the sides are very, very clean. So I'm happy with that. And I'm very happy with how the colorway stitched up. So it's a little bit blown out. There's a little more depth in these sand tones here. So as you can see, there are some sandy tones, then the navies, and then some green speckles through. So it's a very speckled colorway. And it happens to be that the way the dye was laid in the pan, you get this kind of, it's a pleasant pooling. It's not too garish. It's not very, it's not like bright pink shoom across the sock. You know, it kind of flows together. So when you look at it as a whole, it just looks pretty speckled. But if you look really closely, you can see that it's a regular type repeat. So that's my finished object. I'm happy with it. Oh, also here, I meant to say, I wish I kept the tension a little bit tighter, at least across the stitches in the back, because this part, even though I wanted to keep it stock knit so I didn't have too much pulling on the heel in either direction because it's a short row heel, I wish that these stitches were slightly tighter, or that I did ribbing on the front part of the sock and stockinette on the back so that it would at least cinch a little more, because this part right here is extremely baggy on the back part of my foot. So it's slightly long, probably, I want to say I'm remembering when I put it on my foot, probably about an inch too long. This part is very baggy. The cuff fits well. The foot fits. Now it fits, not blocked. So, which means it will grow and it won't fit. So I was intending to just use this as a display piece for my local yarn shop. But yeah, so it's my first finished sock. I'm very pleased with it. And I think I'm gonna try some different things when I knit up the rest of this. Maybe try a 3x1 rib and do a 3x1 cuff. And then do 3x1 on the front part of the sock. That will be a challenge. So that's finished object. In terms of work in progress, I have one work in progress that's almost finished. And you guys are going to be like, Kayleen, you said you weren't going to cast that on. So I said I wanted to finish my coastline shawl before I cast on the cozy shlanket. But I really wanted to cast on the cozy shlanket, okay? So I did. And if you follow me on Instagram, I started this last week right before we got major snowstorms. And as you can tell, turn this right side out. It is enormous. It is scrunched up on the needles. But this is my cozy shlanket. I couldn't resist casting this on for a couple reasons. One, I put coastline in timeout because I wasn't enjoying it. And I thought, why am I going to delay something that I really want to knit? Especially while it's still very cold outside. Why am I going to delay that to finish a project that I don't want to finish right now? That's just setting me up for failure. And I'm a person that if I'm doing something, I like to be product minded. Like I like to see the finished product, I want to finish it. But if I have too many things going at once or I'm not entirely loving the project, I find reasons not to do it. So like the coastline shawl, I'm not liking my needles, even though it's a simple pattern or whatever, I am finding myself pushing it aside. Same thing with the sweater I was knitting for Cece. I didn't like my needles and how the stitches were sliding, so I put it to the side and I haven't picked it up. And that's why crochet is so great, because crochet goes so fast, like on small projects, that I don't have time to just put it aside and forget about it. and then my socks, my gradient socks, my foot cutout was stuck behind here for so long. I was like, oh, I'll just put it off. I don't want to keep knitting. What if I knit too far? Blah, blah, blah. So I find reasons to put it away. So I'm like, you know what? I will not do this. And I just wanted to cast it on. So here it is. These are the color choices I made. So these are all my hand-dyed yarns, which I'm very pleased about. This is Amortentia, which is a nice pink purple toned variegated yarn. It's all similar tones. Then we have Flowers for Dobby, which is a very subtle colorway. It has grays and sandy tones, so it's kind of like a grayish with a pink flecks. And then this grayish stripe is actually a grayish color. I dyed specifically to match Dobby. So you can see it's very large. I cannot stretch this on my cables. It goes from my nose to like my pelvis. Like that's how long it is. If I hold it to the top of my head, it goes to my belly button. Not blocked. Still on the needle, still working. So I've just finished the last garter stitch section of this shawl. I am very much loving working on this. I don't know if it's because it's the weight of the yarn, the colors, what I'm liking so much. But here is the last transition with Amortentia and Dobby. And then Dobby was a whole garter stitch section. And now I'm back to the tonal grayish for the finishing edge. So I'll put a picture here of the shawl, Mina's picture of the shawl. So I'm on the final edge piece where it's like a kind of like a knit three, purl three looking type pattern, or knit two, purl two type thing. So I'm in the setup row for that. I don't want to talk too much about the pattern itself because it is a paid for pattern, but it's totally worth it. This was a very, very, very fun knit. I've been working on it since last week, since we started with the snowstorms, and I'm almost done. So hopefully I'll be binding this off tomorrow or the day after. Definitely this weekend I want to get it bound off. And I'd like to put this down in my local yarn shop as a display piece for my yarns. even though I just want it for myself to cuddle. But I think it looks really nice, and I think that the color choice ended up being really great. So here's what all the colors look like together. There are some mistakes. So there's one big mistake, but as I said in my last podcast, I don't really care about mistakes if they're not going to detract so much from the aesthetic of the piece or so much from the functionality or fit. If it's a small mistake, or even if it's a bigger mistake, as long as it's not interfering with those things, I don't care. So in this section, you'll notice that I'm missing an eyelet, and I think somehow my yarn over to make an eyelet got dropped in one of my rows. So here's the little eyelets. There are sections. There's like three sections of eyelets that go down, down, down. And right here is the missing one. So I was short a stitch. So when I went to do the next row of eyelets, I had to add a stitch because I wasn't gonna take back, because I don't know how to add back a yarn over. I'm not very good at all of that stuff. So there's a mistake in there, but because the yarn's variegated, it's a little bit difficult to tell where it is. Like, I know where it is, but if you're just looking at the piece from afar, it doesn't detract from the aesthetic. So, yeah. But you can see the eyelets here as well, but I didn't make any mistakes on this part. So, but if I had made a mistake here, I wouldn't feel as bad ticking back or like putting in a lifeline and just ripping back. Because I was so far at the beginning, but because there's so many stitches in the needles at this point, I just didn't want to pull it. So I am on the last border section, going as far as I can with the yarn that I have left, which I'll show you, and then doing an I-cord bind off, which might take a little while, but in terms of knitting with worsted weight, it goes so quickly, I don't think it's going to be a problem. So I'm in the middle of a return row, so I'm actually working on the wrong side right now. Here's what the wrong side looks like. It still looks pretty, but I found that this is enormous, like much more enormous than I thought it was going to be. I did realize it was going to be big, but I wasn't sure if it was going to be this big. So I was a little nervous coming in that last garter stitch section, finishing it up. So this is all that's left of Dobby. So this is what Dobby looks like in the skein, and then this is what's left from knitting in my Shlanket. So I don't have enough Dobby to do the bind off. I might have enough Amortentia, so this is what's left of Amortentia. It's a pretty significant amount. I'll have to weigh it. Mina says that you need a certain amount for the bind off, somewhere in the ballpark of 15 grams, maybe a little more. So here's what it looks like caked up. And this is Amortentia in the skein. This is a different dye lot, but this one is a little bit darker, but it comes out with the same type of depth here. So yeah, I'll have to decide how I'm gonna do the bind off, weigh this. And then here's what I have left of the grayish. So I'm on that last section. This yarn should get eaten up pretty quickly. I'm hoping, you just go back and forth till you run out of yarn for this part. So I'm hoping I get at least 8 repeats of the pattern for the border. So it's just tonal grayish, nothing crazy, but it matches very nicely with the rest of the yarn. So that is that. I'm extremely pleased. I don't know, Mina, if you watch this, but this pattern has been an absolute pleasure to knit. I am so excited that I'm going to have this piece in my collection, and I'm happy I stuck with it. But I'm really loving the yarn choice. I wasn't sure about the variegated stuff, and it's funny, I wanted to touch on this, because I bought the pattern when it was still the mystery knit along, like right when she announced it. And I wanted to just cast it on right away, but because I didn't know what it looked like, I couldn't do it. I wanted to make sure. I'm too paranoid about yarn choice and like what's gonna look good, because initially, well, after the fact, when the pattern was finally done and the mystery part was over, I was looking at everybody's finished pieces and looking at where the colors fell. And initially, I wanted to do, Where's Bobby? There he is. So initially I wanted to do these three colors. So this is a Wool and Vine. This is Pandora. I caked it up as a double strand, so it would be two strands of fingering held together, so it would be about a worsted weight. But I thought that these two colors were too similar. I didn't think it was going to read as well, because once I started knitting, once I got to the first eyelet section here, where Dobby is featured for the first time, I didn't think that these colors were going to sing, like, individually. They would be too blendy, and I wanted it to be able to show off what was there, because there are pink flecks in here, there are black flecks in here, but I didn't think that the tones were different enough in real life. Here they're looking very different. You got a very creamy tone undertone for this and a much more gray undertone here, but I just wasn't happy with it. That's why I dyed the gray, and I'm happy I did. So this is gonna go, this is on an MCN, and I already have a caked up double, so I think I'm going to do something crochet with this. Maybe I'll do something knit, I don't know. but yeah, it's a beautifully soft yarn, but that was my original choice. But I couldn't do it. I couldn't pick the yarn without knowing what the pattern looked like or which colors were going to be next to each other, because I'm too much of a control freak when it comes to colors in my stuff. So anyway, let's put this away. Oh yeah, I have this in my TARDIS bag. So this TARDIS bag, I have one more of these left. So these were made for a set that I did for the Exploding TARDIS colorway. So it fits well. I had three skeins of yarn and my project in here. My whole Shlanket fits in this bag. Apparently it really is bigger on the inside. So yeah, so that's my Shlanket, my sock, and then that's it. I didn't really work on anything else this week. I haven't worked on my fingering weight blanket. I just haven't wanted to work on it. You know, I have to want to work on it to do it. I can't just do it. So that's all I had to share about that. So now we'll talk about some dye stuff and some shop update stuff. So if you're interested in that, you can just stay, hang out with me. And if you're not, then I'll see you next time. But yeah, so last week I had a huge, huge shop update. I still have lots of skeins left over in different colors, which I'll show you here. I dyed up, I think, four different colorways or five different colorways and some sock blanks. And I dyed them across several bases, so I dyed at least 12 skeins, like, across the bases. Most of the time it was around 15 skeins at a time, and I dyed every single day last week. So I dyed a lot of yarn last week, and I'm going to show you that just in 1 second. Okay, so I've already shown you a couple things that I dyed. So one of them was Mooney. It is for Lupin, RJ Lupin, who's a character in Harry Potter. If you don't know, I dye a lot of Harry Potter yarns, fantasy themed yarns and such. So this was a really fun dye. I used a similar dye technique to what I do for Molly Weasley, which is a more peachy color. So it has a similar feel to it when it gets knit up. And that's what I made my sock out of. I also dyed up a bunch of flowers for Dobby, which is one of my most favorite colorways. It's a grayish colorway, you know, just gray sandy tones, and then like pink speckling. So very delicate speckle, and it knits up very delicately. So I have found, like, I've done a lacy shawl, I did a scalloped shawl. I don't know why he's not sleeping, it's stressing me out. I did a scalloped crochet shawl, which was lacy. It kind of loses a bit of the pink feel, like the speckles, but it knits up beautifully in stockinette or in garter stitch, or with a simple pattern. So just like on my Shlanket in the eyelet section, most of it is kind of stockinette looking, and then you have the little eyelet, so the color still gets to sing. So I dyed up a bunch of that as well. I dyed up a bunch of Amortentia. So this is the color that's also in my Shlanket. It's very, very pink purple. It's a cool tone pink, a more warm purple, and then a very deep kind of aubergine winey merlot type color. So it has a very nice contrast, and this time on my everyday sock base it actually dyed up the way it was supposed to. So if you have been following along for a little while, my first dye of this didn't go exactly as expected because it was the dyes blended together on my everyday sock base for some reason instead of remaining in a very contrasty type variegation. But it knits up very beautifully. I enjoy it. And then another colorway that I dyed up was the Slytherin Common Room colorway. It's a colorway I haven't dyed in a while. This is on worsted and everyday sock, what you're seeing it in now. So very greens, blues, you know, the common room for Slytherin is in the dungeon. It's under the Black Lake. It has really murky water windows showing in, so you get this really ethereal green, yellow, murky, slimy feeling, you know, but in the best way possible. So that's how I painted it in yarn, which I love as well. I did some sock blanks, so there were 5 sock blanks that I had posted. There are 2 left of all 5 sock blanks that I dyed. So this one is Nagini. This is Nagini. These are single knit sock blanks. So this is a very green, oh, it's getting blown out, sorry. It's a very dynamic green colorway with very deep blacks, and then there are some red blood toned kind of speckles, as you can see through the sock blank. So it's very snake feeling. It feels like a snake skin the way it dyed up. So very cool. I really enjoyed doing these. I ordered some more. I got some more sock blanks in yesterday, so I'm hoping to dye up some maybe today, if Tucker actually goes to sleep after the podcast, while I edit the podcast. So hopefully that will be good to go. Let's see if I can. Yep. And I like the technique that I'm using to dye these. I've taken to really liking how it comes out. The sock blanks that I just got, it's from the same supplier, but they feel like they're a little more loosely knit, which should make the dye process a bit quicker. So this is Nagini. And the last one that I have here, this one is Herbology. And I did a few green tones blanks. The other one was Salazar, but it was more acid green. This one is more kind of blue greens. It's hard to show because it's wanting to blow out on the camera. So there you go. More gray tones than black. So still very murky feeling. But these lighter areas that are getting blown out, this is a pale blue green, some greens, some browns in it. And it's very dynamic, so when you knit it up, it's going to speckle up, it's going to have a lot of interest. So again, single knit sock blank. And I'm hoping to have more dyed for you guys in the next week. I know there are some sock blank knit alongs that are going on, most specifically the Crazy Sock Lady is doing a sock blank along, I think April? I can't remember. I haven't watched her latest episode and I can't remember. If you have not checked out the Crazy Sock Lady podcast, you should. She's really sweet. But she's doing a sock blank along, and she had recommended my shop for sock blanks, and I really enjoy dyeing them, so I'm happy to dye more for those who need a sock blank. And then, I'm saying a lot, for Valentine's Day, which is now past, but this kind of applies for all of springtime. I did a pastels minis set. So these are very very delicate. Delicate's the word. Delicate colors. We have a pastel yellow, pink, purple, green, and blue. So I dyed them in inspiration from the Smarties Sweethearts candies. Or Smarties, I guess, if you like Smarties, but those nice pastel colors for the spring. So if you're a pastel person, I do have a few of these left on Everyday Sock and also a few left on Sparkle Sock, and it's called Be Mine because it was dyed in inspiration for Sweethearts. So if you're a pastel person and you're feeling these colors, you should come on by the shop, check it out. I have some available. These were really fun to dye. I was pulling out all my mini skeins and, like, you know, tying them up in groups so I could dye them all together and they wouldn't get tangled. And my daughter comes up, she's like, can I help? Can I help? I'm like, sure, you can help. Not really. She won't really help. She just makes a mess. But these were really fun too. So I have some of these available. And that's about it. I don't think I had any other. I had Wig and Tree. I had a couple skeins of Wig and Tree that are still up in the shop. Ooh, I should go get them. I'll go get them. Okay. So I got a couple things. So things that are in the shop still. So this is Wig and Tree. One of my most notoriously difficult to photograph and show colors. But I have two skeins of worsted that are in the shop right now. I'm not sure if I'm going to send these away. I've been in touch with Mina, the Knitting Expat. If you've not heard of her, Mina Phillips, she's a knitwear designer. She has a podcast here on YouTube called the Knitting Expat Podcast. She's one of the larger podcasts, but I was just chatting with her over email. I'm going to be sending her some yarn for giveaways and or for knitwear design. She liked these colors. So if you're watching, Mina, this is what it looks like. I haven't decided what to send yet. So this is Wig and Tree. It's very red, brown, green, purple type colors, so all the colors of fall. It's a very layered color. It is probably the most difficult color I dye in terms of dye techniques. Getting things just right is very hard. So I dyed some up for a custom request, and I have actually a custom request in for 12 of these, so I'm going to have to dye. But here's the color kind of laid out. So it's very fall feeling. These came out much more red and they're showing up very, very red on camera. They're very fall. I don't know how else to describe it. Normally these come out with a little bit more purple tones in it, but these came out very strongly red, more red. Was a very good job showing. So I'll show this game again, I guess. Okay, so here it is close up. This is Wig and Tree. It is blowing out like mad in here. So that's way too vivid. That's too bright. That's too bright. It's not that bright. This is it. very, very fall feeling. Greens and browns, oranges, purples. Nice, really deep purples. This is purple. This is showing a brown, but it's purple. Purple and red. Purple and red. So it's hard to photograph this color. It is really, really difficult, but it is probably my most favorite color. And I feel like it knits up so beautifully. It knits up, it reminds me of like a fall cornucopia type thing. Where it's just all the best colors and feelings of fall. So yeah, Wig and Tree. And then the other color that I have in the shop right now, I still have a couple skeins of Molly left on Simple Sock, which is my singles base. So fingering weight, single ply, 100% superwash merino. Molly is sandy browns and grays and peach. So it comes out very nicely, knits up very well. One of my favorite colors as well. So that is the end of the podcast. I don't have anything in terms of shop update. I'm thinking the next shop update is not going to be this Saturday. Why is he not sleeping? It's been an hour. It's been an hour. An hour. Anyway, it won't be this Saturday. I don't have any new dyes. Aside from the customs that I had this weekend, most of them have gone out. I still have a few left. So yeah, I probably won't do a shop update this weekend, but I'll likely do one next Saturday or next Friday, depending on my week. We have a birthday party to go to next Saturday, so I'll have to check the invitation, see what time it's supposed to be at. I'm also supposed to teach crochet next Saturday, so we'll see. We'll see what time the update ends up being. I like the 1 o'clock time slot because I feel like it's friendly for Europeans and it's also friendly for West Coasters because I'm on the East Coast, so we'll see. We'll see how it goes. So yeah, I guess that's it. I don't really have much of anything else for you today. I hope you all have a wonderful weekend. Enjoy the weather wherever you are here. We're still snow. If you like the snow, go out and enjoy it. And I hope you're doing well and feeling well. And all my love to you guys. I hope you have a fantastic weekend. And I will see you in my next podcast. Bye.